Hello and welcome to MacFormat's weekly Apple Extravaganza. I'm Chris Finn.
I'm Matt Bolton.
And on this episode, we talk about chips.
The future of movies.
And we also talk about a printer that's unlike any printer you've ever seen before, unless you've seen this printer, in which case it's exactly like that printer, but I suspect you haven't. Let's start with news from the world of Apple. 5 minutes, and once again, I have picked a topic, not only that, in fact, that I know nothing about, but you know everything about.
Again.
Which
this,
is...
You remember this is supposed to go largely the other way.
It's supposed to go the way around, but I'm the editor, so I've made this decision, and it seems to be working quite well for me so
yes.
far. A couple of days ago, Apple introduced an update to the MacBook Air line. Quite a minor update. The processors was the only thing that changed. They went up from 1.3 to 1.4 gigahertz. In fact, the price dropped slightly as well. I think it starts at 749 now for the MacBook Air line. So the processors weren't the only thing to change, really, but technically they were. And you immediately questioned the timing in particular of the processor change.
I was a bit confused because Apple's upgrades are stuck a bit by being connected to Intel's upgrades.
Yeah.
If Apple wants to update its processors, it needs Intel to have something new to offer.
Which wasn't always the case, because like back in the day, when the very first MacBook Air was introduced, that was only made possible because Apple was given early access, exclusive, unique access, to a particular chip technology that Intel had developed for these small, low-power form factor machines.
Yeah.
But you're right, those sort of innovations are quite few and far between, and that between those big things where Apple gets a competitive advantage from Intel, it is stuck to Intel's roadmap.
But even then, it was still stuck to Intel having to make it.
Yeah, that's true. It's just that Intel made it for them.
Yes, basically. but still, what it does is it limits what Apple can do and when Apple can upgrade to a degree. We're actually waiting for the next generation of Intel chips to come. They're due very soon. That generation is called Broadwell, codenamed Broadwell. The current generation is called Haswell. Currently, everything except the 13-inch non-Retina MacBook Pro runs off a Haswell chip.
Yep.
Broadwell is coming soon, as opposed to offer better battery life for more power
yep.
and much better GPU performance for integrated GPUs. But that's not what the new MacBook Air uses.
No.
It uses a Haswell chip that is, as far as I can tell from looking at the Intel spec sheets, just 0.1 gigahertz faster than the last one. Although Apple says maybe an hour better battery life.
And why, we don't know. We'll test it and try and find out.
Exactly. But it seems odd not to have waited for Broadwell to me because even if Broadwell is 2 months away, we don't know exactly how far away it is. It's had some delays. But if it's 2 months away, then assuming that Apple sticks with its usual yearly-ish upgrade cycle with this current MacBook Air, then it's going to have last generation technology when everything else will have.
But that might not be a big problem.
Generation.
I mean, that might not be a big problem because already currently the technology in the MacBook Airs is very good. The Haswell stuff gives you utterly competent performance and it gives you phenomenal battery life, 9 or 12 hours, on the 11 and 12, 13-inch MacBook Airs. It could be that Apple just wants to, because we talked before about like, deciding between a 13-inch MacBook Air and a 13-inch Retina MacBook Pro, that's quite a tough sell because even though the prices are slightly misaligned, the performance, the specs, the weight makes them feel quite similar. So Apple might just want to put Broadwells into the MacBook Pros and create some clear blue water, as the marketing people have it, between the Air and the Pros, and just leave the Airs with some slightly older but still solid technology, but then upgrade them in a year's time.
I don't see the clear blue water, especially if Broadwell gives the MacBook Pros nearly the MacBook Air battery life.
Mm.
In some ways, that's going to reduce the water between them even further.
Yeah.
But also, it potentially gives a advantage to competitor Ultrabooks, as non-Apple MacBook Airs basically are called.
Yes.
Because if they can put Broadwell in, at the moment, they get worse battery life than the MacBook Air. If Broadwell gets them closer to the MacBook Air, then Apple's lost a competitive advantage.
But is that a buying decision that happens? People decide between a Vaio that's got a particular, well, not a Vaio anymore, but a Vaio that's got a particular set of specs and a MacBook Air?
If that set of specs, if they've been looking at battery life and that was the advantage of the MacBook Air.
But it's strange because you think people partly buy Apple with their hearts rather than with their heads. And I do wonder if people do that spec sheet comparison.
I think that's an overgeneralization and simplification.
Okay.
I think if someone's looking for a long... Well, let's put it this way. If someone said, I want a long battery life laptop, and I want it to be thin and light, you say MacBook Air. That's the best option, unless you have Windows-specific stuff you need to do. It's, you know, there's always edge cases.
Yeah.
But if that isn't the case anymore, like, it literally cannot bend. I can see no benefit to doing it this way, except maybe to do with making it cheaper. Although Intel's list price for the two chips, the old MacBook Air chip and the new one, are identical, so shrug. But I see no benefit to doing it this way. I can only see possible ways for it to go wrong.
It might be that it updates it before the end of this year anyway. We don't know.
Then why update now?
Well, exactly, Matthew.
All right, let's move on to our next topic in the wider world of tech. Okay, and as ever, Chris doesn't know what I'm going to bring up. This is 5 minutes to talk about possible changes in how we view new movies, because the CEO of DreamWorks has said that he believes that the best model for new releases going forward will be a 3 week period-ish where a new film release is only available at cinemas, and then after that available at home, still in cinemas, available everywhere, and that the price will depend on effectively the size of the screen you watch it on. You would let people watch it for $2 on smartphones, $5 on TV, and $15 or whatever the current rate is for going to see it at the cinema.
Literally size of screen? Because that seems like an oddly spurious thing to... Because like I might have a tablet that's bigger than my laptop that's smaller than my, you know... Like,
yeah.
Is it not just like sort of use case? So mobile, home... cinema.
That's a more realistic way to view it.
But that's
his specific thing that he said was,
so it's like X inches.
But he was giving a point. He was giving a concept more than he was
laying out a specific.
Yeah, he didn't have a matrix of different screens and stuff. And it would be like impossible to track and confusing, because if I put it on my iPad and AirPlay it to my TV, how much do I pay? But and there's things I saw someone saying. In the comments to one of the articles talking about it, he's talking more about the quality of what you get delivered rather than an exact inch size, you know, smartphone quality, TV quality, blah, blah, blah. But what if you have a 1080p smartphone and a 1080p TV?
Yeah.
Really, you want the same the same quality on each. So
was he proposing this as a thought experiment to galvanize discussion, or was he literally saying, this is what we are going to do?
It was a thought experiment because...
He can't do it. Unless you build your own store, I guess. You can't do it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, all the home stores, I'm sure, would be quite happy to go in with him on it. The problem is the cinemas still have quite a lot of power, I believe, and could do him in.
Yeah.
But it was sort of a thought experiment, but it was more than that. It was him saying, I believe we will have to move to a model like this.
And is that predicated on piracy, basically? That... If you leave something in the cinema for too long and don't allow people the chance to download it onto their devices at home, they'll just torrent it.
I didn't see that piracy was used as the
yes, he might not have said
example.
It. He almost certainly wouldn't have said it, but is this a fair thing to infer, do you think?
I think you could infer it a bit. I hope it's more just common sense and him realising that the old model can't just keep stringing it along and... hoping that people won't get annoyed and wander off and watch something else, for example, if someone else does this first or something like that.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. It really does, because the lead times are insane, but still, between the cinema and DVD release. And especially, we've still got regions confusing things further.
Yeah.
And even though there aren't regions explicitly with like digital downloads, they're still there. I tried to use an ultraviolet disc the other day.
Oh, it's the worst.
Oh, man. Actually, so bad. Talking about regions, I saw somebody, I think it was one of the journalists on Macworld, could have been Chris Breen in Macworld US, talking about how great the Frozen experience was when he bought the disc for Disney's new animated film Frozen. Because with that, you got, it was a pack that had like the Blu-ray, the DVD, and digital download codes for various things. And they said the experience was brilliant because you went to the particular site, put your code in, but it was an agnostic code, and then that spat you out to, do you want iTunes, do you want ultraviolet, do you want something else, which
good.
Was great.
Yeah.
So then I bought the disc of Frozen, and it doesn't do that in the UK. You get Blu-ray, 3D Blu-ray, and ultraviolet.
Yes.
And ultraviolet is horrible.
Terrible.
It's a really, really unpleasant experience.
You know, Veronica Mars film was a big thing because it was kickstarted.
Yep.
And they obviously, the people who kickstarted X amount were promised copies at the end, and they got ultraviolet copies. And the experience was so bad, and they kicked up such a storm that I can't remember which company it was, Warner Brothers or someone, gave them all, I can't remember if it was credit or gifted them all copies of it on iTunes.
So it just literally against their bottom line.
Yeah.
To do it, but it was such an unpleasant experience. Basically, it's still boned. It's still, the whole thing is a bad experience. But it does sound at least like some of the senior execs in some forward-looking companies are beginning to think about it in slightly more imaginative ways.
Yes. The possible problem is that this guy makes film. I don't know how much he deals with
distribution.
Exactly.
Which is the problem. It's the gatekeepers. Same problem we had with last week's show with net neutrality and the Comcast stranglehold.
Yes.
So it's the gatekeepers that are causing problems.
Difficult to get everyone on board.
Indeed. Let's break there, and I'm going to set up this printer, what I mentioned earlier. And here it is. This is the Cricut, well, or the Cri-Cut, as I keep wanting to call it.
But it's not called that.
I just want to call it that.
Yeah.
It is called the Cricut. Let's start my 5 minutes. And what it is a die-cutting printer. So rather than like splattering paper with ink, it cuts stuff out.
So when you say printer, does it do any printing?
Well, yes.
Okay.
Kind of. I just call it a printer because it's kind of easy metaphor. But there are two things here, as you will see, A and B. A is for accessories. So you can put various things in it, like a scoring tool or pens. You can pop in there.
Okay.
So it can actually draw with the pens as well.
This is so lo-fi.
But it's also got in here the blade.
Right.
And I have here some vinyl. So you can basically cut a whole bunch of stuff. You can cut, I won't switch on just yet. You can cut obviously paper and card, even like quite thin metal you can cut, or plastics, that sort of stuff. And because what you do is you take your substrate and you affix it, here's one I prepared earlier.
Yes, very good.
To one of these mounting boards, which are slightly tacky, slightly adhesive. And when I say tacky, I mean adhesive, not kitsch.
So I put whatever I want to cut, stick it to that.
Yeah. And then you use a software, which interestingly is cloud-based. It's in a web browser. It's not an app.
Okay.
So you take your thing, and you can basically buy designs from Cricut if you want to, or you can make your own, completely make your own. You can upload bitmap files, pings, JPEGs, and then vectorize them.
Oh, so you make them in drawing apps and
things. Yeah, but even pixel art is fine because it will vectorize them for you.
Right.
Or you can upload SVGs.
So I can use Microsoft Paint.
Yes. Good. So let's switch this on. Also, there's little drawers in here, look. So you've got tools.
It's got a storage section.
It has got a storage section.
Is it going to be keeping loud?
It's going to be slightly loud. But we'll see how it goes.
Like washing machine dial.
Yes, come cameraman, have a little look. So we have here like a range of presets for various different types of material, which sort of presets speeds and pressure and that sort of stuff. But there's also a custom thing there. You can completely customize yourself, but they've also added a whole bunch of stuff like canvas, I think is one of them, and denim. So you can actually,
I can use custom to expand the range of what's...
Absolutely, okay. Or completely make it yourself. So we have here a thing. Let's see if we can make this work. And you get quite a nice little simple diagram. You can position things. The software is actually really nice, genuinely really nice to use.
And it is all running in cloud.
It's all running in the cloud. And something's not working.
No. Well, obviously.
we can cut.
So, Chris, we've just taken a brief pause in recording.
Yes.
While you've connected your laptop to the internet to use this cloud application.
Shut up.
Do you see this as a downside to people at home who may have poor internet who would like to use this product?
Shut up. No, I don't. It's fine. So what we do now is we put this card in and press load. And then we set the correct material to vinyl, which it is. And then we press go. This thing caught. Come on. There we go. Just checking it's actually going. Yes. That is it now cutting out.
Yes.
It costs 250 quid.
Which doesn't seem unreasonable.
I can't get a clear answer from the company because of all the variables involved, how long a blade should last. But I get a really clear idea from one of the people I spoke to there who does a lot of work with this, that it should actually last a really, really long time. So I was worried it would be like the inkjet model, where the machine was cheap and the blades would not last very long and be very expensive, but it seems not to be. And obviously, although you can use your own their materials, you can also just buy like, you know, cardstock or anything you want, really.
Is it one blade fits all, or like if you wanted to do the metal stuff, do you need a tougher blade?
There's also a deep cut blade, it's called. So it's a slightly stronger blade that doesn't wear out quite quickly for really hardcore stuff.
Okay.
And that is it. The demonic noise is over. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to disconnect the machine and switch it off. And then, oh, by the way, I should show you down here, Mr. Cameraman. There's little storage pots.
You already
in
showed
here.
Us that.
Did I?
You no,
I think I showed you. Oh no, I did. But you can also put like blades and stuff in here. This is how they come, with a little plastic waxy coating, and it's magnetic, so they don't move around. Which is nice. Anyway, you can now put that on the floor. Now, bear in mind, I haven't done this before, so I might screw this up badly. But let's give it a go, shall we? So because I've done vinyl, what I can do is use this terrifying looking kind of dentist tool.
During the break, we were wondering
to hook out
what that horrible thing was for.
The negative spaces.
So do you seriously not think that it being an online only thing is going to be a problem at all?
I don't think it would be for most people, I think. Do you reckon it would be?
It's, the internet for a lot of people isn't as good as it is for us here in the middle of a city.
That is true. I will grant you that. You should keep asking me questions while I'm focusing very hard on this.
I'm sort of distracted by the...
Now we do this.
It's quite an elaborate process.
It's quite an elaborate process. Now I'm going to take this little squidgy tool, which apparently is very good for taking the ice off your car windscreen as well.
That sounds sorry, like it would ruin it. But
sorry, microphone.
So there's just one model that size. Is there a bigger... like a bigger one for doing more elaborate projects? Or?
Oh, quiet you. Let's go a bit longer on this one. No, there is one model this size. I'm trying to remember. I'm supposed to take it off here first. These mats that you can use are, as you can see, slightly sticky so that the material you put on top doesn't move around.
Yes.
I'm going to redo that. The reveal for this is going to be amazing.
How many times have you done this?
Once. Actually, not even once. Come on, you beauty. There we go. And then
this is quite...
peel this away. Oh, no. No! There's a fantastic lady came down to demonstrate...
Come on, cameraman, get over his shoulder.
There's a fantastic lady came down to demonstrate this earlier today to me, and she did offer to come and help. I was like, no, I'll be fine. But obviously you could do a whole bunch of stuff with this. You can cut out card, cut out fabrics, you could cut out vinyl that you could then use as a mask with like etching paste or something, so you could etch designs onto glass. All sorts of fun things.
What's the maximum size of that printer? A4, A3?
It's actually, well, because it's kind of predicated on the craft industry, which is very US based, it's actually based in inches, so you get a 12 inch by 12 inch pad, which can go as large as 12 by 24 inches. Now I've slightly, but only slightly, cocked this up, but it's okay, because I've just got to take out this negative little space here. It's fine.
You've just gone straight through, haven't you?
The pressure I feel doing this. Right. And now let's get my laptop back. Oh, there's also in the software a nice little button where you can flip it. So if you're doing like iron on transfers or something, then it'll flip it for you automatically.
Okay. Do you need to cut out iron on transfers?
For extra
Maybe
special
I just don't
detail.
Understand.
All right, and then again, sorry, microphone. Da 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 da! Slightly didn't quite make that work. It's okay. This is great television. Bosh!
Wow.
I now have my own personalised MacFormat. Is it straight? Yeah. Is it even vaguely straight?
It's a little bit straight.
It's a little bit straight. Just like me. So it's. I think it's really quite fun. It's not expensive. I can imagine actually one of the interesting vectors for this, I suspect, even with its kind of attempt at being gender neutral in styling, I suspect a lot of women will buy it, but I suspect a lot of husbands and boyfriends will find themselves having uses for it because it's really quite cool.
I would, when you say it's not expensive, I don't know if I'd go that far.
Well, it's not overpriced, let's say.
Yeah,
it doesn't sort of strike you as like, oh my God, that's really, really pricey. And there is an iPad app coming with Bluetooth connections, so you'll be able to do that sort of stuff.
So that will work offline, will it? Oh, no, because you had it connected by...
Over USB I did.
Yeah, sorry, I'm getting confused, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, there you go.
It'll still be all cloudy.
It'll still be all cloudy. I think it's really quite fun. You can, because it's cloud-based, all your stuff's stored online, so you can print stuff out. The software is actually genuinely, it's one of the most impressive web apps I've ever seen. It's really, really easy to use. Doesn't feel like a web app. It's very, very powerful. And you can do fun things.
Very nice.
Well, what do you think of all that, what I just said, and what Matt just said? We started off with chips. Do you actually care that the MacBook Air is slightly underpowered? Let us know in the comments. Do you think that cinemas are still raking it in with their horrible popcorn prices and just the monopoly of the cinemas is still insane? Do you think that, in fact, films should come out quicker than they actually do? And will you buy a cricket? Not a cricket, a small insect, but one of those things.
Cause I saw the story about the guy who bought 1,000 crickets in a box and they all escaped. So don't do that.
Let us know about any of that stuff or indeed any thoughts that come into your head in the comments box below.
Don't forget that you can subscribe to our YouTube channel to see all of our future episodes and other videos.
Our future episodes. Oh yes, future episodes. He's right. Keep going.
Thanks. And that you can view some of our past episodes by clicking on the button in the middle here, and that you can go to macformat.com/iPad to try out our interactive iPad edition of MacFormat magazine with lots of lovely bells and whistles and a free trial.
Indeed, that's it for this week, but we shall see you next week.
Bye. Do you have the internet up here?
I shouldn't need it.
Well, that's not how cloud works.
Yeah, I do.